Now let's start with our next country, Pakistan. The traditional sports of Pakistan included in this documentary are Ludo, Gilli Danda and Rassakassi. Now let's talk about Ludo. Its origin. Ludo was originated in India by the 6th century CE. It was called then Pachisi. The earliest evidence of this game in India is the depiction of boards on the caves of Ajanta. This game was played by the Mughal emperors of India, a notable example being that of Jalaluddin Muhammad Akbar. Special areas of the Ludo board are typically colored bright yellow, green, red, and blue. Each player is assigned a color and has 4 tokens in their color. The board is normally square with a cross-shaped play space, with each arm of the cross having 3 columns of squares, usually 6 per column. The middle columns usually have 5 squares colored. These represent a player's home column. A 6th colored square not on the home column is a player's starting square. At the center of the board is a large finishing square, often composed of colored triangles atop the player's home columns, thus depicting arrows pointing to the finish. The formal rules for playing Ludo are as follows. Roll a 6 to bring your first pawn on the board. Roll again to determine how many spaces to move your first piece or pawn. 2, 3, or 4 persons can play this game. Each player starts the game with 4 pieces in his yard, the area in the corner of the board. Players decide that at random who takes the first turn. A player starts his turn by throwing the die. A throw of 6 is used to enter a piece from the player's yard to his start square. Alternatively, it may be used to advance by 6 spaces one of his pieces already on the track. Any other throw is used to advance one of the player's pieces already on the track by the appropriate number of spaces. If the player has no pieces on the track, then the turn is lost and the die passed clockwise around the board to the next player. A throw of 6 allows the player another throw after the corresponding move is made. A second throw of 6 similarly allows a third throw. If the third throw is 6, however, the throw is lost and the player's turn ends. The course of a piece from the player's start square is clockwise around the board till it arrives back at the end of the arm of the cross from which it started. It then proceeds up the central row of spaces on that arm till it arrives at the middle by an exact throw. At the middle, the piece's journey is over. A player cannot land one of his pieces on top of another. Only one piece may inhabit a square at once. A piece can, however, pass by another friendly piece. If a piece ends its move on a square occupied by an opponent's piece, the opponent's piece is taken and returned to that opponent's yards to begin its journey again. A player wins the game when all 4 of his pieces have reached the center of the board. Other players may play on to see who gains the second and third places. The cultural significance of Ludo is connected to Mahabharata era. It has been said that the famous Pandavas and Kaurava brothers have played Pachisi game too. Now let's hop on to our next game, Gilli Danda. Gilli Danda is an amateur sport played in the rural areas and small towns mainly in Pakistan, Nepal, India and Bangladesh, and also in some parts of Cambodia and Italy. The game is played with 2 sticks. The large one is called a danda, which is used to hit the smaller one, the gilli. Gilli Danda is an ancient sport of India, possibly with origins over 2500 years ago. The other names of Gilli Danda in other regional languages are Tip Cat in English, Dandi Bio in Nepali, Gilli Danda in India too, and Danguli in Bengali. Now, let me read out the rules for the Gilli Danda game. The boy on the left is about to strike the gilli with the danda, while the one on the right is fielding. Gilli Danda is played with 2 pieces of equipment, a danda being a long wooden stick and a gilli, a small oval-shaped piece of wood. It is played with 4 or more players of even numbers or even 100 players. Standing in a small circle, the player balances the gilli on a stone in an inclined manner, somewhat like a seesaw, while the other end of the gilli touching the ground, and the other end of the gilli is in the air. The player then uses the danda to hit the gilli at the raised end, which flips it into the air. While it is in the air, the player strikes the gilli, hitting it as far as possible. Having struck the gilli, the player is required to run and touch a pre-agreed point outside the circle before the gilli is retrieved by an opponent. There are no specific dimensions of gilli danda and it does not have limited number of players. The gilli becomes airborne after it is struck. If a fielder from the opposing team catches the gilli, the striker is out. If the gilli lands on the ground, the fielder closest to the gilli has one chance to hit the danda, which has to be placed on top of the circle used with a throw similar to a run route in a cricket. If the fielder is successful, the striker is out. Or if not, the striker scores 1 point and gets another opportunity to strike. The team or individual with the most points wins the game. And if the striker fails to hit the gilli in 3 tries, the striker is out, similar to a strikeout in baseball. The cultural significance of gilli danda is again related to India. It has been said that over 2500 years ago, during the Mauryan Empire, the subjects of King Ashoka used to play this game. Now, let's move on to our next game, Rassakassi, or popularly known as Tug of War. Its origin. Nobody actually knows that since which date the game of Tug of War has started, but it is mentioned in most of the ancient books of Egypt, Greece, China, and India. Tug of War is still popular among certain festivals in the UK, the rest of the Europe, India, Pakistan, and Nepal. The formal rules of Tug of War. It is an 8-a-side game as per the international rules and regulations set by the International Tug of War Federation. The weight pack for both the sides is pre-decided so that one side does not get the undue advantage because of it. Both the teams then get aligned with the two sides of a rope which has an approximately 11 cm circumference. The rope has a mark of a center line, and further there are 2 markings of 4 meters on the either sides of the center line. When the team starts to pull the rope and when that 4 meters center line crosses the center, the other team wins the round. Skills and techniques required for playing Rassakassi. The basic position which a player needs to maintain primarily is shown here. This is the motion required to maintain the center of gravity. This one is the static pose, which is a form of a playing technique. This is the dynamic pose, which is used for playing. This is the basic walking posture with the application of force. And this is the indoor walking posture with the application of pull energy. Power walk is an effective walk used with enormous amount of pull force. And absorb attack is a kind of posture which effectively pulls the opponents down to them. The cultural significance of this game is very important. UNESCO has now recognized the value of this Rassakassi game or tug of war game, and it has added the game to its list of the world's intangible cultural heritage items. In an Indian mythology, it is even mentioned that sun and moon played the tug of war to decide their supremacy over the darkness. It is also believed that the churning of the sea, that is Samudra Manthan, fought between the gods and the devils, was somehow related to the Rassakassi game. With this, now we have come to the end of a Pakistan documentary. Thank you so much everyone for being cooperative and watching our presentation. Thank you.